that's certainly true, but you mentioned the idea of kind of the algorithm for identifying terrorists, right? This is something that we hear a lot in the media, that, okay, the companies can take down content that's child pornography, why can't they do the same with terrorism? And there are clear technical reasons why that's true. You know, if a company is scanning files that are uploaded to its servers for a known list of content that it doesn't want to display, that's one thing. But trying to do, as Shahed was saying, sort of dynamic evaluation of the ideology of the comment, that's highly contextual. That really depends on having a human do deep reading of a comment. And as we've discussed a lot, companies make mistakes sometimes. They have error rates that are not zero. And especially as Rebecca was mentioning, if those errors the company makes start having the backing of government action, if it means that somebody erroneously gets identified as being associated with terrorism or is having posted something that violates the law and in fact it doesn't, the consequences for individual users just skyrocket from having an unsatisfactory experience with a particular platform to having some kind of getting put on a list for some sort of monitoring or having additional surveillance of your activities. So we know some technical reasons why those kinds of approaches won't work, but I wonder if for any of the panelists, are there things that you think tech companies could be doing to better support the kind of strategies that Shahed was discussing to create more opportunities for countering the narrative?
Well, I think tech companies sort of push for security of users. Everything that tech companies can do to promote a free and open internet that is secure for individuals, not just governments and large corporations, but secure for individuals and small groups, for small entrepreneurs, for small media organizations. The internet can be as free and secure for them as for large, powerful entities. Is a fundamental first start, right? So that's not only building into your technology the security and sort of defending your right to do so as a company, but also policy advocacy and making very clear commitments as a company to the rights of your users and demonstrating through your actions, through your policies, that you are actually implementing these commitments. I think we've reached a time now where we can no longer just say, I'm putting the technology out there and it'll ultimately make everybody free. I mean, that's a dead idea, right? That's not how it's working. It's not how it's playing out. But to really make a commitment in how you conduct your business, in how you design your technology to protect and defend the rights of your users, and really think about, okay, how am I dealing with government demands? How am I dealing with government pressures? Join organizations like GNI, who actually helps companies kind of work as a group to push back and create frameworks for defending user rights, because there's actually a whole body of knowledge and experience around this. You don't have to just go it alone. But also really joining, sort of supporting the advocacy work, that not just, there are oftentimes when Facebook telling the UK government your law is crappy, the UK government kind of says, well, you're violating everybody's privacy, and Facebook doesn't have a lot of traction there, but kind of working together and supporting civil society who have messages around the free and open internet, and supporting policy coalitions that are defending the free and open internet, I think is really important.